right, everybody. Welcome to our very, very first episode of the new WAKApalooza Happy Hour Show. This is a little podcast we're putting together to get everybody to talk about all the fun stuff about WAKApalooza, all the events we're doing, all the events coming up, and for you guys to get to know what's going on with the Dream Team, the crew that's putting all this stuff together. So want to take a moment to invite you guys to definitely subscribe to our new WAKApalooza YouTube channel, because we're going to provide a ton of content on there. And if you haven't already, we've got the awesome WAKApalooza Instagram channel, where we've got daily photos and topics that we're talking about. And of course, if you're not already subscribed to any of our Facebook SGP pages, get in on that. Get in on that, okay? Because this year, 2020, it's WAKApalooza all the time, every time. And we're going to start off today by introducing you guys to our awesome team. We've got several of our Dream Team members here today to talk about Scottsdale and what's going on this year. And so I'm going to introduce you guys to everybody. First, we've got Peyton Neal. She's out from Southern California. You guys know her because you pose for her all the time, and then you bitch about her not posting anything on Facebook later. So,
I mean, they does can't that intentionally that this time. That nobody can get mad this time.
So good this time.
My photos are posted, but there was someone who genuinely, I can't remember who it was, who made a bet that Scottsdale photos we posted before Vegas, and I wish he had put an actual bet because he was right.
Yeah, missed out. Could have taken you to dinner or something. What happened?
Well, I wouldn't go that far.
We also got Juju Black here. She is joining us from Arizona. She's here for diversity purposes.
What was
that?
Wow.
What did you say?
I just said you're
something
here for diversity.
Something he can edit out?
Yeah. No, you can put that in. You're here too, Sasso. We're
hitting 2 things. I know, right? It kind of works. And then, of course, we have Adam, who is from South Florida. I just realized we have 2 Florida people on this call because Peyton's also from Florida. Wow.
I just represent both sides of, you know, the crazy.
Anyways, hopefully you guys all know who we are. If not, don't be shy when you see us at any of the events. Come say hi. We'll have a shot. We'll have a drink with you guys. But in case you don't know who we are, we're going to do a quick introduction and bio of everyone, just so you know. So I'll start. Once again, my name is Saw. If you don't know me, I've been a part of CLUBWAKA for, holy crap, a long time. I'm like the senior guy here. I've been around since 2006 as a player and have been doing events with you guys since forever. Oh, forever. And I know a lot of you guys have done a lot of these fun events. So big diehard fan, love the community, love all you players, and can't think of a better group to be a part of. Peyton, tell us a little about yourself.
Hi, I'm Peyton. Most of you know me because I usually have like a camera in my face. So, you know, like this part.
This part.
Stop it, Sa. Stop it. I have been a part of CLUBWAKA. I started in 2013. And I started working with Sa in early 2015, maybe late 2014. And I've just been kind of addicted to all of this ever since. Kind of jumped in head first, as many people do, drank the Kool-Aid. And I love it. I've been having a good time.
Yeah, we love you. How about you, Juju? How long have you been part of this racket?
I started playing in 2014 and then stopped playing in like 15 and started working for the company in 15. And started working with events team like what, last year? 18, 17, 18, something like that?
Yeah, last year. Last year.
Yep. So
whenever things started getting awesome is when we got Juju.
Yeah, kinda. Let's not make our head any bigger, okay guys?
Yeah, a little bigger. Just the bigger.
You know. Yeah. All right, Huss. You got the
beauties to the beast.
Fact.
Accurate.
I've been part of WAKA's community for 14 years now.
God, your enthusiasm's killing me, man.
I am old and tired.
I'm proud to say I wasn't even 21 14 years ago. Hey.
No, it's been a phenomenal 14 years full of amazing trips, friendships, and working for the company for about 6.5 years now, actually over 7 now, and doing events for, I believe, 4.5 years at this point.
That's awesome. Well, speaking of trips, let's take a moment and share what our favorite event or trip was that you've ever been a part of. I'll go first. My all-time favorite still has to be the very first event we did, which was the West Coast Cruise.
Cruise from hell.
Yeah, that we effectively got banned from. So, yeah, that was one of my favorite cruises. We talked about trying to bring back the cruises this year, but this coronavirus is kind of putting a kink in the details, even though, you know, prices are really good. So I don't know.
So, quick question. Yeah. That first cruise, there was someone who almost got left in Mexico. Who was that?
You know what? You weren't on that cruise, so you can't talk about it.
But still, with those photos actually got uploaded.
Screw you, Peyton.
I made fun of myself.
News flash on our very first happy hour episode. We're going to see our first firing.
You're fired.
You know, we're creating history in this very first show. Great job.
Who got left? Who got left Mexico?
So there's like, you know, two guys. Pick one that was actually on the cruise.
Stupid. I did not almost get left behind.
Okay.
I was found passed out in the street and I was brought back onto the boat. Okay. I did not get left behind in Mexico. I'm sure if this person didn't find me, someone else would have found me on the way back from the bar crawl. So
thank God everybody is dressed like Santa. Nowhere near Christmas.
No, we weren't dressed like Santa for that one. We were wearing wigs. We had giant. Oh, I had a giant Afro wig. So, yeah, that was really bad. That was really bad. But you know what? The funny thing is, me being almost left behind in Mexico is like the vanilla story
of that
event. Okay, so.
I just remember going and looking on the cruise, like the people that frequent cruises and the review board, and if you go and you search for history on it, there's like a 70 page thread on like some subreddit type of thing where it's just, what the hell were these people doing? There's children on this boat. And it's like, we tried to warn you. Sorry.
It's terrible. Well, I'm bummed you weren't on that cruise, Peyton, because you know, it would have been pretty epic. I mean, you were pretty epic on the second cruise, but you know, the floor is yours. What's been your favorite event?
This is an easy one for me, actually. My by far favorite event is always summer camp. For me, it was the first summer camp, though. It was the one that I actually, there you go. But for me, my favorite was the first one when I didn't have to work. but all the summer camps have been amazing after that. What?
Nothing.
What'd you say?
Nothing.
No, but it's so incredible to do it from both sides, honestly, and to see on the one hand, you know, how much fun it can be as someone who goes, and then to see it from the counselor point of view, how much work goes into it, and how you, and not to like make your head any bigger, but you actually make sure that we still have fun. And it's just such an incredible environment, and there's a cap on it, so like if you don't like you, there's only so many people that can go. And so it doesn't get too big, and it's such an awesome, tiny environment, and you're just stuck with each other, which can sound awful, but it's so much fun. And you really just get to know people in the middle of nowhere for 3 days, 4 days, and no sleep, obviously, but it's the best every year.
Yeah, it is a great time. That's awesome. Yeah, I remember you having a really wild time.
Yeah.
It was a good time.
Yeah.
How about you, Juju? What's been your favorite?
I'm so glad I don't have any of these stories. So good. I would say my very first WAKApalooza and my very first Scottsdale. So that was like consecutive. So 2014 and then 2015. And I was captain of my team. So like, this is when I still played like hardcore, and I had no idea Waka was like a company or anything. I was just like, oh, they do this thing in Vegas. Let's go to Vegas and just whatever. And I showed up and I was like, this is insane. What did we get ourselves into? And I was like, we got to come back to this every single year. And I remember I walked in and like a bunch of people that worked for Waka were like, hey, you post all this stuff on Facebook all the time. We need to find you and talk to you. And I was like, I don't even know. This is a company. Like, I just wanted to come to Vegas and play some kickball. I was totally had no clue what I was doing or what we got ourselves into. We got combined with what is now the main Lumbersexuals, but they weren't the main Lumbersexuals at the time. They were just like, we
Lumbersexuals.
Yeah, they were like, they don't even know what they were.
They were just sexuals.
It was like Dina and all them. It was like all the girls.
Yeah.
But none of the guys. And it was just so random. And now we have this like weird like Phoenix main connection thing. So it's kind of this like great love story. And then Scottsdale was dope. My very first, that was 2015 Scottsdale and rowdy.
Yeah. Though nothing like today's Scottsdale.
Yeah, no, it's like that was wild. But from like a player standpoint, because like Peyton was saying, like it's so different on the like staff and like event side of things. Like there's so much work that goes into things that you wouldn't even think. Like like WAKApalooza last year, I was like, this is like organized chaos. I don't know how. I'm like, people have no idea. We do such a good job of never letting.
We do such a good job. I just want to end it there. We do such a good job.
Yeah. Okay. Well, hopefully. I mean, we got a survey to go over later. Adam. Yeah,
true.
Out of all the things that I have attended, I would say that the best event that I've attended is actually the shirt I'm wearing, the one and only CLUBWAKA Space Camp. It was by far one of the coolest experiences, especially, you know, it's one of those things, especially being a kid in the early 80s, you grew up always seeing the ads for Space Camp, and it's like, I can do this and I can drink because I'm an adult. This is phenomenal. But it was just a great experience, not just the Space Camp, but overall. Just the 3 days that we were there had so many fallout stories and just funny happenings that took place that people are still making jokes or hashtags about to this day. So definitely the one that resonates more than any of them else.
That's awesome. Is it your favorite because that's also the site of your lost love?
Oh, God. I hate that.
I mean, okay, I'm sorry. If you guys want to know more about Adam and his lost love at Space Camp, you can message him privately. But
you cannot message me privately. Adam is very happy right now.
Oh, that's right. Yes. A certain lady may be watching this.
We also, like Adam's girlfriend. Help him keep her side.
My bad.
Seriously.
Anyways,
I like Adam's girlfriend.
Anyways, this is our, like I said before, this is our very first happy hour episode. And as you all know, every hour is happy hour somewhere. So we've all got our drinks. Actually, in fact, let's talk about what you got on deck with you. Ooh. Well, I'll start. This is a special occasion since it's our very first episode. I busted out a vintage bottle of my favorite white Cabernet. It's a 2011 white Cabernet from Wilson's Creek out here in Temecula. Nice little blue bottle. It's a cab, but it comes out as a white wine, and it's absolutely fantastic. Probably should have kept it chilled a little longer, but yeah, that's my drink of choice tonight. Peyton, what do you got?
I'm still at work. So I just have a drink in a cup that we can just assume. Some of us can't say that we have things in our drinks.
Isn't that like every day for you?
I mean, gotta keep
Juju, what do you got over there? Hennessy and Coke?
Yeah, obviously.
Wow.
We already know my favorite drink is wine. So I found this bottle. It's Menage a Trois. Ah. That was all my thing. I didn't have time to go get white wine, so red wine it is tonight.
Very cool. Us, what do you got?
I've actually gone with a phenomenal pairing tonight. We are doing Publix raspberry flavored lemonade and Kettle One. Ooh. And I have paired it with carrot cake Oreos.
Disgusting. I mean, you had me at Publix and then you just ruined it from there.
He's like, now we know why you lost your love at summer camp, but that's, or space camp. That's okay. Anyways, today we're going to be talking about Scottsdale because that just happened last week. We're going to be sharing about our favorite moments, recapping the tournament, of course. And then the big deal that we're doing for the first time ever is we're going to do a review of this, the surveys you guys did for us. And we had a tremendous amount of participation for that. So definitely thank you. That is something that we want to do moving forward, going over the survey so that you guys kind of know what everybody else is concerned about, what they like, what they don't like. And we obviously want to answer and address any of the concerns that you have out there. So don't worry, we'll have a printed version of the survey results released next week as well. I'm probably going to include it in that GMOT that's supposed to come out next week. So stay tuned for that. And then, of course, at the end of today's podcast, we're going to go over all the things to look forward to for the rest of the calendar year. So it's going to be exciting. And of course, one of our biggest events is summer camp. If you haven't been, you definitely got to check it out. We're going to take a quick moment here and show you a little video of what summer camp is like, and hopefully you can join us. Summer camp. Hopefully you can join us. Remember clubwaka.com/events to see all the events coming out. Summer camp is almost sold out. I know we've got less than 20 spots left. It's our number one customer survey rated event. So it's a very unique event. It's different from the tournaments. It's different from the cruises. There's really no way to describe it. Check it out. If you have any questions, definitely hit us up on social media. Follow us up on Instagram. You can see some of the photos that we're going to, videos that we're going to be posting up really soon. All right, so let's get to Scottsdale. What a year this year. 600-plus players, 40-plus teams. It was insane. I don't know how it used to go from a small little event, you know, when Juju was talking about, to the insanity it was this year. It's kind of hard to wrap it all up. But, you know, let's start with, let's start with what our favorite moments were. Adam, why don't you go first? What was your favorite moment from Scottsdale? Now, you went as a player this year, not a staff. So I want to hear your perspective of what you really liked about Scottsdale this year.
So it's Scottsdale, I think, it is a pivotal staple within our tournaments because of the fact that it is the first West Coast one post WAKApalooza. So a lot of people haven't really seen each other, especially in the Southwest, but this year was great because we had so many East Coasters, aside from myself, that actually ventured out and participated in everything. And a lot of them played competitive, but they sure as hell partied like they were part of the Funds Games crew. So it's really cool to see a lot of my folks head that way. Overall, just the overall atmosphere of it, honestly, like, I mean, I could name something that sticks out about amongst everything that we did, from, you know, the phenomenal bar crawls to the brunch this year, having two locations right across the street where it was kind of felt like it was a dueling party situation. Everybody was kind of hopping back and forth, grabbing their food. And then just overall, like Boondocks, Wasted Grain, I mean, all the venues are phenomenal. Prices could be a little bit more desired, but I'm used to it from South Florida, so it's all right with me. But overall, I mean, definitely was a great atmosphere and overall time with everybody.
No, definitely, I agree. But like Elizabeth Warren, you're not answering the question. So Juju, being homegrown, what is your favorite moment from Scottsdale? Not overall, but just what moment, what party or what event stood out to you?
Favorite was brunch after brunch. Like, brunch was dope. Like, that was cool. Whatever. Great. Whatever. But after brunch, the Casa Amigos, that was like the most fun. Like, we literally, it was just us. We took over the place. We had CK and Mancat on DJ, and it was just like so much fun. And what's the cool thing was, like, upstairs, like, people didn't realize, but like, half of the people were upstairs home. And
yeah. Super no, that place was legit. And that's our first year doing this Sunday afternoon party, right?
Yeah, 100% great. I mean, Wasted Grain's dope, so wait, like that's like the night that we all just like go in and have a great time and just party our asses off. But I would say Sunday still is like my favorite day. 100%.
Yeah, Sunday Casamigos was definitely a surprise. I was pretty nervous about that, but you did a great job of putting that event together. And it took a while to get everybody out of there. We're like, I know, you're having fun at El Jefe, but we gotta get
and then, like, the moment everyone got over there was, like, having the best time of their life.
Awesome.
Like, you know how everyone in Waka loves it, but it's just us, so hello, here we go.
No, that space is amazing. There's certainly a lot more I think we can do with that. Who knows, but it's definitely a great venue space. Great job on securing that. I know when we go over the surveys later, it was one of our highly rated locations, so it was awesome. Peyton, this was your first year actually going to Scottsdale, surprisingly. First time we've got you there, so what did you think?
I am still kind of shocked by it. I have had so much FOMO the past few years because people always talk about it. Oh, Scottsdale's the best. I love Scottsdale. So this year I just had to go, and it was beyond all my expectations. I know we're supposed to pick one thing, but like I kind of got to hop and feel so many little things. Like the Hojo, by the way, which I didn't even get to stay at. We had our own place, but I spent maybe 2 hours at the Hojo, and it was probably one of the most crazy 2 hours of my life. It was so fun, but so insane. And like everyone just like packed into this spot and everyone's together and it felt like I was in college again because everybody's hotel rooms were open. Yeah. And so it was just like going in and out of different rooms and be like, oh, hey, who are you? Where are you from? What's going on? It was so much fun. So like, so incredible. But I know we're supposed to pick one. I'm going to pick two because my number one favorite thing, no, like I had the really cool opportunity that nobody else got. And that was giving out free Bud Light with Jimmy.
I mean, oh yes.
Like so how jealous. Do you top that? Like Jimmy and I literally got to drive around the fields for like 3 hours, just giving teams Bud Light. And there's few things that get Waka people more excited than free stuff. And what makes them more excited is free booze. So for giving these teams free Bud Light and seeing like people loving on Jimmy and seeing Jimmy loving on these players was like, if you ever get 5 minutes with Jimmy, he is Waka. He is like the end all be all. He just lives, eats, and he is Waka. So getting to spend all that time with him, seeing him interacting with the players, and getting to give everyone free Bud Light, I just felt like Oprah of Waka. You get a beer, you get a beer, you get a beer. Now smile.
No, the pictures were great. The Bud Light thing, which shout out to Damon Cross from Las Vegas.
Totally.
Did a great job securing that deal last minute for us. And we decided to surprise the players day of at the tournament. But yeah, that was awesome. Not every flavor was awesome, but yes, the whole Bud Light seltzer was pretty good. Stay away from the mango.
Oh, the mango's so bad. Oh, God.
I didn't actually try any of it.
I did not try it. I was like, try how horrible this is.
He's like, but we got some great photos. Thank you to all the players that pose with the pictures, because that helps our sponsors realize the excitement of aligning their brand with us. We want to continue to do more of that throughout the year and provide more value to you guys. So we definitely appreciate your support. Again, shout out to Damon. And of course, thank you to Peyton and Jimmy for driving around distributing booze, because I know how difficult and hard and painstaking that is to do that.
You're welcome. You're welcome.
So difficult.
It's a hard job.
Well, speaking of Saturday day, we had a big tournament out there. Essentially three kickball tournaments. So it was a long day and we crammed it all in that field. And for the first time ever, it was split like it was in Vegas. We had a Founders Cup division for the regionals. We had a kickball open division, which had all the new rules. And then, of course, fun games, which we brought on some of our big hitters with Danielle DeVoe and Kristen Apodaca helping Kenny. And introducing a little element of some fun challenges before the games actually started. A quick recap, shout out to our finalists for the Founders Cup division. It was Minaj and Fiesta de Basura, right guys? Yeah. And Minaj pulled it out in the end, and they are a collection of quite a few players from all over the country. Adam, you know a lot about Anthony and his team. You wanna give us a little bit of insight as to his crew?
Definitely. They're no strangers to championships. They actually won NOLA two NOLAs ago. Definitely a mishmash of players. Predominantly is from South Florida and made up of well-established teams such as Hazard, Not Today, Beast Mode, now Showtime, my apologies, as well as, you had Jeg, who is a West Coast staple now in the Pacific Northwest, that ended up coming down and joining them as well. So, very good mishmash of players from all over, but predominantly Southeast.
You just made Jeg's night or day or whenever this gets posted by saying Jeg is a West Coast staple. Let's go, Jeg. Shave that beard. Let's go, Jeg.
Don't shave your beard. Don't listen to her.
Well, Fiesta de Basura is another awesome squad as well. They're a staple of all of our tournaments, the Vegas crew, and not necessarily always under that team banner, but always a fun group. And the awesome thing about both of those teams that I know everybody here can talk about, they party, they rage. They were out Friday night late, the bar crawl. They were raging hard Saturday night at Wasted Grain, and they were definitely the life of the party at brunch, at one particular table, a modified spin the bottle game, if you will. Let's just call it that.
I'm just amazed that those teams made it through pool play, much less made it into the championship game, because they were out so late Friday night and they had to be, like, there's no world where you're not hungover on Saturday morning if you're those people. And then they're in the championship game. I'm like, it's insane.
Yeah. Well, any team that Adam Szymanski is a part of, him and his crew will be out late and then chugging four locos all day at the field. So.
I don't even think being out late was a problem. I think they all had an Airbnb together, so I think that was even the
more. Yeah, their back of the house is partying until the sun comes out. Oh, man. And then we also had our kickball open, which is the first time ever we've tried these new rules in which all male kickers have to kick the ball. The ball has to go past that first to third line. So it essentially eliminates soft, hard bunt. Any type of bunting is essentially gone because the defense has the ability to stop the ball before the first to third base line and therefore make it foul. So I had the opportunity during the day to ref several of their games. And I'm telling you, it was exciting. It was a different brand of kickball. We made it the defensive alignment had to be five guys and five girls, and it just opened up gameplay in such a different way. It was nothing like what we had in Vegas, where it was, many complained that it was kind of Founders Cup light. Brand new ball game, one with five girls. You had to put a solid girl in the infield, and we saw teams rotate ladies in the catcher position, in the pitching position, key roles, and then of course, with the girls being allowed to bunt and the guys having to kick away, we saw the opposite of what we see in a lot of Founders Cup lineups, where a lot of the ladies are stacked at the bottom. Now you had consistently ladies in the 2 and 3 spot kicking, and it was just great to see. The game evolved throughout the day. We'll see later in the survey how people felt about it, but it was definitely an exciting brand of kickball. And with our very first rule set, big shout out to Buzz Bees and Clutch Vegas for making it into the finals in a very exciting game that went down to the wire by one run. And of course, Buzz Bees was able to hold out in the end and win their very first championship. And yeah, it was a real exciting day. I thought it was fun to watch. Peyton, I know you got to see a couple of games. What did you think?
Yeah, something that was really great for me to see in the open games is how many fun games teams or fun games players were playing in the open. And that was kind of cool for me to see how they really were out there. They wanted to be competitive, but they loved these new open rules. So they moved over to a more competitive way to play. And they were just having a great time. And I love seeing these players that you consistently see, you know, like going crazy in the fun games and stuff like that. And they were going crazy at open games and they were having a really good time, but playing hard at the same time. And I think that, like, I feel like we kind of were finding that balance for that middle ground that just you never could find before, because it was either founders or fun games. It was either you compete or you party. And I think open tournament is such a great middle ground where you're finding people who want to have fun, but they want to have fun competing. Like, and so it's just that really cool middle ground. And I love seeing so many familiar faces that I normally see, like, in a onesie, you know, right, playing with a hula hoop, and they were, you know, in a onesie, but like bunting it right down three and getting there. And you're like, wait, how did that girl, I didn't know she could play. Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, no, definitely. It was really fun and exciting to see that. And we're definitely bringing that that format into a few more tournaments to just finalize the rule set, to iron out any kinks. And we're hoping that we're going to have a good turnout for it in Vegas.
Awesome.
Of course, that leads us to the fun games. Just always our wildest and craziest party animals at any event. No compromise here at Scottsdale. And it was really cool to see the teams come out. A lot of people with crazy setups. And of course, I think we implemented some new a new challenge at the beginning of the fun games this year. And I believe the Bananas ran away with it, right? The homegrown team, right? Juju, I know you're hanging out on that side a little bit. Tell us what's up.
It was fun. I missed the fun game, like that, like free fun game thing from watching some of the open, but the actual fun game side, it was a little bit smaller this year. I think it was like only like 8 teams.
Yeah.
But they were having a blast. Like, I mean, people had kegs, they were doing keg stands. We're doing like, they're playing flip cup. You know how it is. Like, they're not playing kickball, they're just playing slosh ball. They're having the best time ever. Mighty Drunks, shout out to them. They really brought it this year. I mean, they always bring it, but like, they just have so much fun. Like, this is exactly what we are looking for and what it is like to embody like a fun game team. They're amazing. Chalupa Batman cracks me up. I don't know his name, but the really tall black dude. Oh, what is his name? The one that dressed up like Madea or whatever.
He dressed up for every event.
Some of the best photos of him, and I've got to, like, I'm gonna get them up because he has killed me all weekend. Like, he cracked me up. Like,
yeah,
the bouncers at the clubs were like, who are you?
Did you remember him at the bar crawl in that red burgundy dress?
Yeah, he was like, so... or something. I was like, I cannot. It was hilarious. But no, they all were awesome. Like, Lumbersexuals, they all, like, we all know that they are like the party team to party with. So they're having a great time. I mean, everyone was just loving it. Like, there was like nothing bad, like no drama on the fun side, which was amazing.
Oh, I know, right?
Something going on, you know, but it was literally like everyone just had fun and it was the best ever. So,
yeah, you know what? Shout out to the fun games players. I thought it wasn't as, it's the best phrase. What's the best one? It's not as trashy as it's been in the past. You know, we weren't picking up people off of the ground and getting them home this year. So yeah. I thought that was really good. Juju, did you have of all the teams in the tournament, did a particular team kind of stand out, or was one of your favorites to hang out with all weekend?
On the fun side, definitely Mighty Drunks always, just because, like, even though, like, I don't really know the whole crew, like, I know Stacy, I know Letty, but, like, other than that, like, I don't really know most of them on the team, but, like, I have so much fun just going over there because they're so welcoming and so inclusive, and, like, that's the biggest thing with me who walk. And we're not, like, exclusive, like, we are meant to bring everybody in, everybody wants to be part of it, so that was, like, one of my best things. I don't know, like,
and
I hung out with
so many of them.
Yeah, they're, I mean, yeah, Chalupa Batman was really fun. They're a blast.
Oh, I love their color combo and outfits. It's such a, yeah, that it's logo so and design is so.
So how do we get our staff shirts to be as cool as the Chalupa Batman?
Right.
Outfit, like,
I don't think you can get as. I mean, it's called Chalupa Batman.
Okay. I mean, well, so they've got the other Peyton on their team, and I think that she helps design stuff.
Oh, yeah.
We need the better Peyton to come on our team.
The blonder Peyton.
No, they're awesome. They were so much fun. I don't know who else. Like, Sleep Me Alone. There we go. Sleep Me Alone. They're, that's what it is. They always have the best themes. Like, they were, like, Australian. I think they were just Outback people.
I don't know if they knew what
they were. They had a didgeridoo that they were blowing the whole day. And I was I need to get it up.
Oh, my God.
That's one of those easy teams to appease. All you got to do is put on Toto Africa. And
God. It was the best.
Oh, man. Well, Peyton, you were driving around in a golf cart for a lot of days and taking pictures. And anybody stand out to you that you loved?
I mean, I think everyone knows that, you know, Juju already put it. But there's just something about the Lumbersexuals.
Yeah.
You just can't, like, they're everywhere, first of all. Even though there's not even that many of them, they're everywhere, and they're so much fun, and they're so, like, welcoming and excited to see any staff member at all times. And they just always appreciate it so much, us so much. I love them. Also, the bananas this year, the bananas were just, like, so having fun. Like, there was just something about whenever you saw the bananas, it wasn't even necessarily craziness as much as it was just, like, whatever was happening. If they were just standing there, they were having such a good time, and it made you have a good time. Like, I'd pull up to, like, you know, kind of see some roughing, and they'd just be, like, standing with each other, like, dancing. And, like, that's awesome. To me, that is what, like, you know, you don't need an event. You don't need it. Like, yeah, we have all that great stuff. But they were just, like, having a good time.
That team does a good job. They definitely reflect a lot of Megan's personality.
Yeah.
That she exhibits, so that's really cool.
And she runs a dog.
I know, right? Adam, how about you? You have a team that, you, besides your own team that you were playing with, anybody that was fun and unique for you?
I'm going to say the Mighty Drunks so I don't get fined or broken up with.
Man. Who's second to the Mighty Drunks?
Second to the, yeah, exactly.
Wow, ball and chain is all I got to say.
I had a blast hanging out with a lot of my hometown folks. I had a blast once when my team wasn't playing, hanging out with the Minaj guys and catching up with them. I stayed predominantly on the KOFC side of the fields. I did see, when I was walking over to ref Minaj versus Texas Toast, the Chalupa Batman lined along the canal, since they're all part of one big crew with the Texas Toast guys, literally sitting there giving them a parade of applause and good wishes. So definitely want to give shout outs to Chalupa Batman, because that was really cool. We're like, they literally stopped in the middle of their game and they were just like, Texas Toast, Texas Toast. I was like, what the hell is going on right now? So that was really cool. And then I think one of them actually stumbled and might have fallen in the canal. And that was kind of where it ended.
That canal sucks.
I know. It just divides the whole park in half.
It really does.
You know what? There was at least water in there this year. I mean, there's years where there haven't been water in there. And people just try to run over. And I don't know.
It's better when there's not water. Last year there wasn't water, and you could just walk down and walk back up, and you didn't have to go all the way around.
It's, I don't know why they don't add more bridges. It's so far, but, you know, Hopefully we can find a different park if we can, but if we do, it's further away. That's always the big issue.
Well, that'll become something we can talk about when we go over the reviews and the suggestion for 2x4s.
Right. One of the teams that really stood out with me was the San Diego Buzzbees. And they were just, I mean, I know they have a couple fun game players on there. I believe Sarah's part of the ESB Nation, of course, you know, our staple resident party animals. But it's interesting because I've known Captain Jay for a while. He used to play with the Whores, and then he moved down to San Diego, and he basically kind of, you know, San Diego at the time, a lot of different players were kind of in transition with different teams. And so he put this group together, and I remember at the West Coast Regionals last year, I mean, his team just absolutely got crushed. They got murdered. But, he's an example of a really great captain. Kept everybody together, kept everybody positive. They had a great showing at the Open in Vegas. And at this tournament, they were awesome. And you can see that in how they celebrated on the fields, the way they were. I mean, they were crazy all weekend, especially Saturday night at Wasted Grain. They had their own booth in the nightclub, and they ordered at least 10 champagne. It was, I remember, it was 10 minutes before the place was closing. The barn already said last call. Then all of a sudden, I see all of the go-go dancer girls or the servers come out with candles and lights, and they're bringing out another bottle of champagne with 10 minutes before it closed. They ordered another bottle. They partied like crazy. It was insane. It was definitely fun to see how far they've come and to see how appreciative they were of everything, and they were so fun and friendly, so it was great to see them. Also, big shout out to Hopkins and his crew. He had like multiple, his franchise, his Balls Deep franchise is expanding all over the place, but both of his influences in the Open made it all the way to semifinals. His Clutch Vegas crew made it all the way to the finals. So, you know, he's definitely got his presence in fun games and the Open, and those players are expanding all over the country. So it's exciting to see him. He's always a staple of all of the events. So
all of his teams are always so much fun. They're at everything. They're so like proud of their being part of their team and to be a part of WAKA and Club WAKA. And it's really fun to be around any of those guys.
Yeah. I mean, it's, their acquisition of Chad Bassalone last year was definitely interesting. And I think the right personality fit for, for that franchise. I look forward to seeing more of them at events, but they are definitely fun. Okay, folks, well, let's get to the meat of what we needed to go over, which are the survey results, okay? We'll be posting the graphics on here, but we'll essentially just go over the entire survey. We'll talk about what worked great, what didn't. We'll go over some comments. Again, first and foremost, we really appreciate you guys filling this out because I know you guys complain all the time and think, you know, no one listens to the surveys and stuff, but we do. And especially this particular group with these events, we produce all this stuff for you guys. So if you like this, we'll do this. If you don't like it, we'll stop doing it. You know, we don't have, all of us, we don't care specifically on any particular item. We don't have any personal bias or preference for it. We want to do what you guys like. So let's start with the very first question on that survey, which was ranking all of the parties from Thursday night to Sunday night. And as you can see here, I'll pop up the graphic right here. We had about 20% of all participants, of everybody that went, fill out the survey. So it was a really great response. But as you guys can see, you know, our top three parties, Saturday night, Wasted Grain. Holy crap. That, like, you can see that green bar. Everybody loved that. So many people, that event scored a 10 better than anybody else. Thursday night, The Blind Dragon, another private party. It was a solid event. And then, as Juju mentioned, Sunday Funday at Casa Amigos. I mean, no surprise here. And then, of course, you can see The brunches, the Sunday brunch, a tremendous improvement over last year. I remember last year, I think Whiskey Row was dead last. Dead last. And then, of course, you can see...
You remember.
You can see what was dead last this year, the Friday bar crawl at Cold Bears and Cheeseburgers, which was their first time ever working with us. And what do we always say, Juju?
They're never prepared for us. They never believe us. They never believe us. The worst part is that, like, that's my homie that works in corporate, and he was there, and the manager on duty just didn't believe us. And he was like, I told him. He just didn't want to believe me.
To be fair, though, that happens a lot, not just in Scottsdale, but pretty much anywhere when it's a first-time, you know, activity that we're doing or first-time partnering up with somebody. Is there? I've seen people that, whether they be competition or just overall doing random bar crawl companies, and seen them be like, "Hey, be prepared for this astronomical amount," and then it's something very lackluster.
The problem is like they used to be a sponsor bar for us, so they're aware of how many people show up to the bars, and they've worked with us on events on like separate occasions. So they have like a food truck, and then my buddy was like, yeah, I told him to open up that other area, but he just doesn't want to. He doesn't think that we need it. And I was like, bro, come on.
In that case, shame on them.
Shame on that manager, because it wasn't their GM, unfortunately. But, like, my buddy that was in – I had to drop his name. And then he was like, oh, okay, I'll open it now. And I was like, really, I got to drop his name, like, for you to open this for us? But they know. I don't know. I mean, whatever.
Yeah, I mean, definitely. I mean, you're looking at these results – you know, overall, the bar crawl scored the lowest, which is interesting because, you know, as much as just 2 years ago, a bar crawl was like the favorite event in Scottsdale. Like, that's why everybody came Friday early to make sure they didn't miss this bar crawl, because it was wild, it was fun, it was crazy. But this time it's perhaps the question is, are we too big for this, Peyton? Do you think that it's just bar crawl's not realistic for us anymore?
Well, so, I mean, kind of based off the survey, you know, I was looking at it, and one of the comments was, you know, I love bar crawls, but I think we're too big for them now. Yeah. And I totally agree, because at this point, we're so big, and it's specifically for staff. Please stop making us corral these people's off. But it's so much fun for us all to be together, and that Friday night beforehand. I think at this point, it's either we need to start the bar crawls a lot earlier and have places that we know we have a consistent and good relationship with, or we pick a place and we stick to it. Because, you know, you finally get the bartender's attention, they finally bring you your drink, and then you gotta close your tab and go. Or you like can hang out and really have a good time. You know, oh, you know the bartender's name, you get like, it, you know, you can actually mingle with people. But if it's that big, your sole reaction is get in, get your drink, all right, finally get it, and then you gotta go, and you don't even really have time to mingle with people because you're just thinking about the drink and it's the crowd.
No, you're definitely right. That reminds me about one of the comments posted in this section. It's comment number 10 here. I'll read it to you guys. It's, I love bar crawls, but I think we're too big for them now. It's just not realistic for a bar to overstaff their place for just 1 hour or whatever time that we're there for. As a bartender myself, I'm not coming into work on a Friday or a holiday weekend for just 1 or 2 hours to handle a large group that is rowdy and doesn't tip well. Let's be honest here, kickballers are cheap and do not tip well. Well, you know, that's debatable on who doesn't tip well or not. But the realistic part, I think, is the value. Because if I'm a bar owner, right, if I'm regularly staffing just two people on a Friday night and somebody tells me, hey, I'm bringing 500 people to your establishment, I'm going to have a tough time calling workers to come in for just 1 or 2 hours to handle that crowd, like extra bartenders, extra bussers, extra people in the kitchen, and then be like, all right, you got to blow your Friday night, but I only need you for 2 hours and you're cut, right? So I can understand how that's high risk for people to be able to successfully provide a good bar crawl. Because honestly, every establishment had that issue. They didn't have enough bartenders but I can see a bar not being able to realistically, especially on a holiday. It was a holiday weekend. It's Valentine's, for Pete's sake, right? So I know, Juju, you talked about a different idea that you wanted to think about implementing for Friday.
Yeah, I want to do just like a private event, like how we do it in Vegas. Like find a venue that wants to work with us and just do like maybe a little bit later and do like just a private thing for all of us and maybe have like food, maybe do, I mean, if we can start it earlier, have the whole night with us, but it needs to be just like a one-on-one thing because our players, our people, they like the one-on-one. They like it just being WAKA. They know, and they're not overly critical when it's just us because like they're taking care of their friends instead of strangers. Is essentially, I kind of feel like how our players feel.
Right.
So, like I think a private event, like we can't do a bar crawl. So we're just way too big, especially for how popular and big and booming Scottsdale is. They don't need us. We're just an additive to what they're going to make that night. And right. So it's unnecessary. And there's already so many bar crawl companies in Arizona and that do Scottsdale bar crawls that like, they don't care, you know? Right. So
yeah, no, it's certainly hard. And yeah, I mean, I think it might be time for us to realign Friday so that we can meet the players' expectations first. Because, I mean, I know our players, in theory, the concept of the bar crawl is fun. Seeing as many different places is fun. But the reality is we also want to make sure that you get drinks and you're not spending your time 25 minutes waiting for a goddamn drink, right? So, Adam, any particular comments from the party section stand out for you?
Well, real quick to echo what you guys are talking about, I'm a real big fan for the last 2 years of Social Tap, I believe it is, across the street from Wasted Green. Yeah. They're upstairs and they're downstairs. Service is consistent there. So it's one of those things where I look forward to particularly being in that venue. Mm-hmm. As far as some reviews that stuck out for me, there were two in particular, and they were interesting and they were critiques, but I thought, you know, came with some information. One was, while it was really cool to have a spot for brunch just for us and they opened up early, the limited menu made me feel like it was not brunch other than the bottomless mimosas. And that, you know, it's understandable when people are wanting to hit brunch up and, you know, want the full shebang. But it's also, you know, much like Sa said at the beginning of the of this podcast, that we had over 600 people, you know, descend upon Scottsdale. So it's one of those things where in reality, we want to keep quality going in the best possible way for all of you that are attending. And if we turn around and give everybody this broad spectrum menu that they can order from, it's going to be impossible to fulfill expectations of quality service and quick service to make sure that everybody gets their food, their bottomless mimosas, and gets to dance and have a good time.
No, that's a good point. That was the big change we did with Whiskey Row this year. Remember last year, guys, they had to close down their kitchen within the first hour. Because they have their regular menu out. And the reality is no restaurant is designed to handle 200-300 people arriving and ordering at the same time. That's just not realistic. And the best way to service that is really having a buffet, but that even limits your options even more because you can only pick and grab food that's cooked and available. So the reality is to do Sunday brunch. I mean, I know a lot of people love the intimacy of R&R, but that's just not possible anymore. I mean, and the reason we're not there is they first said like, well, we can't handle you guys anymore. And then we just continued to grow outside of that. But yeah, we still have yet to find a single establishment. I know a lot of comments said, hey, I hated being split. Well, the truth is we haven't found a place that can fit all of us in one location. I mean, you saw how crazy that was.
We filled up both spots.
We filled up both spots.
They let people in Del Jefe, but like they didn't have a table. Like they ended up leaving.
I loved that there were two spots because it felt like the parties were like, because you could see each other in like the outside space. It was like the parties were like fighting each other. And I felt like DJ Mancat and CK1 were just like, in the best way ever, like trying to out 90s jam the other. And like,
yeah, shout out to those guys DJing all day for us Sunday. That was really awesome. Impressive. We need to fly in some more DJs next year. I think we might need to bring back Chocolate Rain to come on out with us. He was a hit out in Florida, or in Vegas. He is from Florida, so so we'll always continue to find ways to improve the brunch experience. Obviously try to expand our menu a little bit more. We did see some people ask for just a little bit more stuff for people with that are vegetarian or gluten-free diets, things like that. So we'll figure it out. We'll try to expand it a little bit more, maybe dedicate one location to specialize in those type of meals while the other one can do a different type. But it's a work in progress for all of these establishments, and we at Club WAKA, obviously you can't come in behind the bar or in the kitchen and run the show, though I wish we could, but we would try to work with these establishments to make it as awesome as possible. Juju, you have any other thoughts on some of the other comments about any of the other parties?
Well, there's one comment I'll like cliff note it because it's long. But yeah. Basically, they were just like, you guys are, it's comment number 9. It says, you guys always do a great job with the parties. Definitely understand how you can't control staff at some bars. And they basically were like, we liked having 2 spots, but 1. And then they're like, can we go to Riot House? Can I hear about Riot House?
Oh, yes. We had several comments about Riot House.
Give me time. So here's the deal. I need people to understand this, that I've said this to you guys privately, but like, Scottsdale is a mini Vegas, and Riot House is absolutely insane at night. Like, on a Sunday late afternoon to evening, it is like a packed club. You cannot get in. There's a line. It's huge. So I think their reservations with working with us is thinking that we're going to cut out, like eliminate being able to get the rest of the people in that they get and like the crowds that they usually get. But during the day, I mean, they could definitely handle us. And they have a big enough establishment, and they have actually 2 DJ booths. Like, if it's set up the way I think it's set up, like it used to be, they've got 2 separate bars. It's the perfect place, but it's just a matter of like getting management and Riot Hospitality, actual Riot Hospitality, to work with us. So.
Well, you know what? I'm glad you brought it up, because now you put it out there for the internet to know that this is now on your shoulders to make it happen.
Fantastic.
I wasn't going to say anything, but now you put it out there for all of WAKA Nation to know about this awesome location that it can do all these amazing things. And now it's just really up to you, Juju. So
why did Star go really Oprah on that?
The only other thing I will say too about this is, like, I don't know where in the comments, like, but it's in one of these, it's talking about like the pricing of drinks and stuff. Again, I have to reiterate, like, living here and going out in Scottsdale, and I live in Old Town, I live right next to the clubs. I promise you guys, like, this is normal pricing. Like, we are competitive with Vegas. We are 5 hours away. We're 45 minute flight. Like, people are coming to us instead of going to Vegas now for parties. So the pricing is reflecting that within bottle service, with pricing of drinks, and just like cover charges that they charge at all the places. So it's definitely something that I think people need to be aware of, that when you're committing to coming to Scottsdale, you're committing to coming to essentially like Vegas number 2.
Right, right, right. No, for sure. Absolutely. Final things I want to note. I know Sunday night at Boondocks this year was a lot smaller than last year. And I think that primarily is just a product of the Sunday Funday afternoon party was such a hit. Yeah, I mean,
everybody was asleep.
People got smashed by the time Sunday night came around. Everybody was like, it was done. So if we keep having an awesome Sunday afternoon party, I think we're going to change up what Sunday night is going to look like moving forward. Probably something small, intimate for people that want to grab a late night bite, something like that. Yes, I'm the one that constantly pushes the Sunday night party, Juju, and you're like, what? Hey, I can hang.
He's gonna plan it this year, you guys.
I'm sorry if most of the players are all passed out, but I'm on team no sleep.
I know. I'll be there.
Can we do somewhere inside next year for Sunday night? Because some of us were a little cold.
Just wear a sweatshirt.
I was wearing a sweatshirt.
I wore a sweatshirt. I was fine.
Rude.
Oh, my gosh. And then one final thing before going on. I want to give a big shout out to Boondocks. They are they always take great care of us. And for those of you guys who went Friday night, you saw how crazy long that line out the door was. And we all got to roll in VIP style right away. So they always take great care of us. I know the players always love that place. So let's definitely find a different way to utilize them next year and make them a big staple of what our weekend's about.
I actually went into there. I went in Monday after WAKApalooza and went to talk to the people that I was working with to set it all up. And they honestly were like, we love you guys. We want you back. They were telling us how all their security was like, all of a sudden, all these people rushed up to the door, and she's like, I tried to tell you that, like, 200 people are going to show up, and y'all weren't ready. This is the manager telling them this prior, and they're like, well, you didn't tell us, and she's like, no, I did. She's like, I've told you this multiple times. She's like, next time? She's like, we've got you, and I just told her, I was like, it was just a busy weekend in general. Like, you are already, like, almost at capacity, but she's like, oh, we want you guys back. She's like, keep working with us. Like, it's one of our league bars, so... They're awesome. I love working with them. And it's another great staple in Scottsdale that we all love to go to anyway. So,
no, they were great. Yeah. All right. On to the next question. We asked you guys to rank on a scale of 1 to 10 what you thought of the actual tournament games. And as you can see on the graphic here, you guys loved it. Shout out to the tournament staff who did a really great job on putting the events together. You see all these green bars, but one thing I really want to note is the excessive amount of green that you see in that middle one, the kickball open regional. I mean, people loved it. A lot of players really liked the new rules. I think we discussed it a little briefly earlier about the format and people liking it. So we're going to stick with it for a little bit and see how it changes it up. I know one of the comments, some people were concerned about the whole 5-5 split. That was the most controversial aspect of the Open, where teams are now required to put 5 ladies on the field. And I can understand that sometimes recruiting can be a little bit challenging, but I'm going to push it back on you guys. If more ladies are enjoying this format of play, I think you should be able to find more girls. And, you know, Adam, I don't know how you feel about this, but I don't have a problem with more girls showing up to tournaments. Do you?
I have no issue with it, you smart ass. one of the comments actually that caught my eye is exactly what you're echoing. It was number 17 when everybody gets to see all this, but being able to stop balls before the first and third line was a great improvement, but making it 5 guys and 5 girls was a downgrade. Should go back to 6 guys and 4 girls in the field. I disagree. I believe that the 5-5 format actually works out better. Being somebody who still plays predominantly, if not completely, competitive kickball, and, you know, seeing where the strategy is very different, I enjoyed watching the games. I enjoyed watching the difference in strategy. But also, every captain is different. Every team is different, differently put together. But I'm one of the people that tells my guys ahead of time, whether they be in the outfield, infield, or anywhere else, do not get in front of the girls. Do not cut them off. I pick up the pieces that I put together my team with on purpose, because I know and I trust them to be able to make the plays just like anybody else. And, it's one of those things where in a co-ed environment like this, we want to be able to have a let the girls play, basically. And this takes away from being something more that you see in common with FC rules, where usually you have 4 girls buried at the bottom or 3 at the bottom and 1 somewhere in the middle of the lineup, put in basically a strategy to move people over. And I think with this format, it makes it a lot more pivotal to make sure that your ladies are in tune with the game and get to have an important piece in it and get to really truly share in the victories and the losses with the rest of the team, where it's not just, hey, you know, guys running and cutting girls off in the outfield for fly balls and stuff like that.
No, right. I mean, there's a comment number 37 echoes those thoughts. First time playing in the open format, loved how much more the ball was spread around, how everyone on the field had to kick, had the ball kicked to them, much less standing around than Founders rules. As a girl, I felt much more valuable. So it certainly speaks to the heart of feeling marginalized in certain areas of the game. And I think for us to continue to grow the sport of kickball, we certainly should have a product out there that allows people to feel like they're contributing in a lot of ways. Anything that stand out to you?
So I kind of wanted to call out comment number 20. It was much more negative actually than a lot of the ones. And it said, "We'll never play the open again with current bunting rules. We had so many fantastic line drives, just getting batted foul by the charger, and that's not the intent of the rule. Also not sure where the 5-girl fielding rule came from, but it's hard enough to field enough girls to field 4 with subs." Like, I'm going to separate those two things because it's two different complaints. Like, with the girl thing, I think we've talked about it enough. Like, I love the rule of having 5 with 5. I think it's going to be better. We're going to have more girls coming out to these competitions. We're going to have more female power out there. I think we're already seeing more girls coming over from fun games because they have the ability. They're not just sitting on the side. They're not just waiting for their turn at the end of a lineup or their easy out. They're actually getting to play. And I love that. As far as the bunching rules though, I think that this is still so new, and this "we'll never play in the open again" kind of just seemed a little dramatic to me. I mean, we're just rolling this out. I love the feedback. I love the hearing more about, because we did get feedback that maybe you shouldn't be able to hit it out, whatever. But never saying you're never going to play in the open again was a little much for me, because the whole point of this is we're trying new things. And I love that we're trying things that are just changing the rules a little. And we're changing up how all the fielding is done, both infield and outfield. And I think it's great. And I had a lot of fun watching the new bunting rules. But I'm kind of curious how you felt after seeing how it went, how you feel about, the ability to hit it foul.
Yeah, no, I certainly agree that the spirit of the rule isn't to punish line drives, which is what this player is talking about. The hard part after much experimentation last year was how to create a rule set that ensured that every guy kicking was not just bunting it a little harder, right? And what we didn't want to do was make it subjective, like, was it a full swing? Did he kick it hard enough, et cetera? So we found that the easiest thing from a black and white perspective for the ref is to, does that ball cross the first to third line? And the reason why we wanted to make sure that the ball crossed the line was because if the defense could stop a line drive and just throw the person out, then that just makes, that also makes it ambiguous, right? Was it a solid line drive or was it just a hard bunt, right? And what we saw in Vegas, where we kept the rule where, the defense was able to stop the ball and throw the person out, it still was like Founders Cup,
yeah,
right? And so you as an open team still needed a really good charger, a really good crasher, if you will. And that's something that outside of Founders Cup, there's just not a lot of players. Guys that are really good chargers and crashers, they want to play Founders Cup rules. They want to charge in. They want to grab those bunts and have the option to throw people out. So if I'm able to stop a line drive and keep it within that before that first or third line, that's still kind of like the same thing, And if you decide that it's not the same thing, then now we have to judge, was that a line drive or a harder bunt, things like that. So it was just much easier. Make sure that ball crosses that first or third line. And I know some concerns out there were, what if the defense puts a lot of guys out there to prevent you to kick and pass the line. Well, if you put a lot of people there, then the outfield's really exposed. So kick over the head or find that gap. But I know there were some concerns about it in the morning of the games. By the time playoffs came around, it was great. Everybody loved it, and there were tons of kicks, line drives. The nature of the game allows you to go through the lineup faster. And chances are, over time, I think we'll be able to extend the amount of innings we can actually play within a full hour versus the Founders Cup model. So, Adam, I know you had another thought about Founders Cup. Was there something you wanted to point out about that?
Definitely. One of the ones that I read that I had a chuckle with, because I played in a team that played in Founders as well, was a very well-run and smooth tournament despite the wonky team ratings. So I don't know if everybody always notices this or anything, but you or whoever is administrating the tournament sends out a roster, and everybody is in charge of putting together rankings on the thing. What we ended up seeing was a lot of teams responding with, here's your one seed, here's your two seed in my eyes, here's your three seed, and then nobody else matters. And that was literally what a couple people actually wrote, was where they felt that nobody else's ranking really mattered. So when you guys are seeing the rankings and you're not liking exactly where your team falls or think that something is askew, you guys got to remember that if we don't have a full a picture painted for us based on your guys' rankings, it's kind of left to interpretation and you know, how we all feel about it, as opposed to leaving it in your guys' hands. So if you guys really want the power to, you know, accurately rank teams in the future, take the initiative and fill out the actual rankings.
Yeah, no, it's certainly a crapshoot, but you know, at the end of the day, I always say, hey, you got to beat anybody to everybody to win the championship anyways, right?
Absolutely agreed.
Right. Juju, anything to stand out in terms of comments for you that you want to address here?
I mean, not really. I mean, I just got, was funny. There's one that says we need more structure for fun games. And I was like, no, we don't.
That's true. That brings me up. There was one comment. I want your opinion on it. I marked it down here. Oh yeah. I saw the more structure, but someone said that they wanted to have champions of fun.
Oh yeah, I saw that. Yeah.
What do you think?
I like that. I would think that if we're going to do a champion of fun, like, I think it's like a weekend long thing. Kind of like we do like in Vegas, where we, like, you have like the most whatever, like spirited team and all that stuff. You could easily have that at a tournament like Scottsdale, where you could be like the champions of fun, and like you could see some crazy fun things happen throughout the weekend.
Right. I found it here. It's comment number 27. The team competition with the hula hoops was fun. Danielle brought that out this year. Would be cool to do one activity with each team we play. Also would be great to have a champions of fun for each WAKApalooza, not just Vegas. So we're not just talking about Scottsdale here. There's no reason that teams can't earn points for participating in various activities and celebrating a winner.
I really like that. I think I cut Juju off. I really like that idea a lot. I just would want to see it on a smaller scale than what happens in Vegas. I mean, the people, like, the Vegas thing is like months leading up to it. I would love to see like a weekend long champions of fun mini version.
Yeah.
Perhaps. Oh, go ahead, Juju.
Well, I was just saying that would be cool. Like, just to have some of the fun teams get together and they could just do, like, we could set up little challenges for them throughout the weekend, because you know that they're at every single party anyways. So why not do something at every single party, which is just more work for us, but why not?
And by us, we mean the fun games people like Danielle, Kristen, Kenny, that whole group.
Yeah, people that aren't on here.
Be there to, like, make sure everyone's having a good time.
Awesome. All right, I got one more comment on here I'll go over before we jump to the next question. And it's similar to what we've talked about before. It's comment number 20. Captaining is a lot. There should be more time between games. I felt I was rushed to write a lineup between each. Sounds like a brand new captain. No, just kidding. Additionally, reffing should not be provided by teams. People enjoy their breaks. It's hard to find two people willing to give that up. I agree with you. Having been a former player, the idea of sending out refs to base ref games sucks. But this is actually a change that was requested by the tournament players themselves over the years, through all the tournaments that we've done, is that we realize over time that the best available kickball refs out there are people who play. That's just the truth. Softball umpires I hire from, they don't do kickball on a regular basis. So for one weekend coming out, they can know the basic rules, but they don't know all the nuances of, like, you guys have seen the kickball rule book. There's a bazillion rules in a bunch of crazy scenarios. You know, the way we do our foul lines are different from traditional baseball rules, looking for things like a double kick, so much stuff. our tag up rules, all of that stuff. And the players over time realized, you know what, I would rather much more have an experienced player base reffing first and third than some random professional softball guy come out and not know kickball as well. And at the end of the day, that's what we found. And that's why we have that with our leagues. I mean, Club Walking used to have hired umpires for home plate, but over time we just saw that there was no difference in quality between a professional paid umpire versus an experienced player. And in many cases, the experienced player was much better. So until we get to the time period where we have a ton of retired players who don't want to play anymore and just ref, we unfortunately need to use this. And I know some other tournaments, they hire refs to do bases, but as you see at all these tournaments, we see complaints all the time about like, oh, that ref was terrible. That first base umpire doesn't know what they're looking at. And it's just, for us, it just seems easier to let's get familiar faces out there, people you trust. Plus, you know, if it's a peer, you kind of tone down your anger. I know that players, because it's a paid ref or some stranger, they'll start chewing them out more and doing crazy stuff. And I don't want Club Waka to get to a point where we have to bring out yellow cards and red cards. I am proud that we are a community that can police our behavior. And when someone's getting out of line, teammates to other peers can go, hey, it's kickball, guys. You know, I know you might not agree with the play, sucks, but let's move on and just do better. Put yourself in a position where that doesn't have to be the case. And it's just, I mean, you see in professional sports, it's reffing is always a problem, no matter if they're making six figures or doing it for free. So we certainly appreciate you guys providing base refs to help us out. And I know through the years, we've seen the quality of reffing improve because of that. So we certainly appreciate that. Peyton, you had a comment?
I just wanted one more from this section.
Oh, yes.
So there was one more comment. And earlier, I said that my comment was 20, but it was 25. Yours was 20. But this one is comment number 19. And it says, the team with the largest setup ended up having to move after game one. It really hindered the atmosphere. We were all the way at the other end, which means we didn't get other players walking by the party like they usually do. And I want to do a real quick call out to this. This was kind of a FUBAR situation that we were put in, and Mighty Drunks and Balls Deep had to move all their setup and go to the complete other side of the field. And I actually just wanted to call out how awesome they were. Like, I don't really have any, like, that we couldn't have seen that situation coming. That was people that, you know, kind of got in the way and us having to move a field that we always use. But those two teams were amazing and they were so cool about it. And I hate that it, you know, that someone felt like it hindered their day, because it looked like they were still having a great time. But I just wanted to call out to them how incredible they were, how positive they were. I know it was a pain in the butt, but thank you to those two teams for picking up your stuff and moving over like awesome people that you are.
I actually want to give out a ref compliment and piggyback off what Sa was saying. It's very seldom that you see somebody that's filling in for their hour on base refing and is actually having a damn good time doing it. I didn't catch the gentleman's name, unfortunately, but it was one of the players from the Sexabolics who refed.
Zach.
Zach from Sexabolics, if you end up watching this. You were the highlight of my day playing first base for my team. He reffed the Scooter Gang versus Suns Out Guns Out game, and just it was like watching Leslie Nielsen in the first Naked Gun refereeing umping behind the plate. He's sitting there doing dance moves. He's like, "Oh, strike!" Like just calling people out. Getting in there, but he was just a blast to just sit there and talk crap with, and made the game a lot more enjoyable for that hour at least.
That's good. I'm glad that you're checking out the dudes while you're playing your game. It's real important. Good to know. I'm kidding. No, Zach is awesome. He's out here from Southern California, and a good guy, fun guy, and glad to hear that there are refs contributing and making a difference. I'm sure he made a difference to many other people besides just Adam. So know that if you have the privilege and honor of getting to base umpire for us, that you do have an ability to impact the game in terms of the way you conduct yourself, your attitude. So we do ask that you don't, you know, don't fumble around with your phone, because that's the home plate umpire's job. He's got the phone to track everything. Stay off your phone, make calls. You can jump on your phone in between innings if you need to. Pay attention to the game. If there's nothing, something you're not sure about, talk to the home plate umpire. Don't be antagonistic, because, you know, at the end of the day, we want them to do the same for you and just provide a good experience for everybody. No one's expecting you to be perfect, but we definitely want you to try your best and give your full undivided attention. So we thank you for that. That being said, let's hop on to question number three. On a scale of 10, how satisfied were you with the other event-related aspects? And we asked you to rank our customer service, registration, communication, and Hojo. And as you can see here, everything scored really well. Again, shout out to the team for doing a good job of providing great service. But you know what? Look at that last one on the right, the Hojo. You guys love the Hojo. What the hell? That green bar is really high for the Hojo. I'm a bougie hotel customer, so my taste is a little different, but I'm glad the customer service and at least your expectations are met, if not exceeded there. Did any of you guys stay at the Hojo?
Nope. None of you guys did. I like sleep. Thanks a lot.
Shout out to Lindsay. Lindsay's in charge of the Hojo for us every year at WAKApalooza, and I know she's out there making sure people aren't bringing glass to the pool.
No glass at the pool.
Taking care of all players. You know, also shout out to the Hojo. As we do every year, we have an emergency room that we set aside that we book. And anyways, the Hojo, I think it was in comment. Oh, it was actually in one of the comments. Yeah, the hotel actually did a double booking. And so we had to use one of the emergency rooms.
I love that. I also love the person who said Hojo shouldn't jack up their prices so much just for the weekend. It's a motel, not a hotel. I'm like, first of all, supply and demand. Like, it's just business. Like, it's genius.
But it's also a holiday weekend.
Yeah.
Scottsdale, like, you're in Old Town. It's like, that's a cheap hotel, people.
I love that. But also, the second part of their comment was, emailed Saw about registration problem and never received any kind of response. Let's be honest, they probably offered you donuts and you're not eating donuts right now. So that's on them.
No, I'll apologize for that. I mean, I don't usually miss a lot of stuff, but a lot of stuff do come in. So certainly if you email me and don't get something, try to hit me up on social media, hit anybody else up on the team, but hopefully you eventually got your question answered.
Yeah. Like the weekends of like those event weekends, a huge thing that like a lot of people do is they'll go, I emailed Saw, but what they don't understand is if you've ever seen Saw's emails on an event weekend, it's scary. So if you know one of us, please feel free to reach out to us. Like if Saw, he has so much going on. If he can't get back to you, reach out to one of us. We can usually answer your questions, if not get your question answered.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And to be fair, it's really not your guys' fault. Sometimes I get a lot of your emails that come to my junk box. Mm-hmm. And I've got to check those too, right? Because if you're
sending hearing excuses.
Or on Facebook, if we're not Facebook friends, it goes into that other category where I don't even know that it's there. You know, so yeah,
those it's are kind all of baloney excuses. He's ignoring most of you. Come to us, it's fine.
There's a ton of us.
Like, I am not ignoring you guys.
That's like the one bad thing that anything on this survey said about Saw, though. I will give you that. Like, it's literally like this is the section that everyone just loves Saw in.
Oh, stop.
They're like,
yeah, what did you pay everybody to put all these comments in this section? Jesus Christ.
So where's that one comment was like, don't change it. Like, if you're not going to change anything, like, don't change Saw.
No.
Saw's got a girlfriend at the tournament.
You just buy drinks for people and they're nice. That's all.
Yeah, right?
Any other comments you want to go over from this section? That
very first comment I do want to talk about. It says, you guys.
Oh, yeah. Go ahead and read it, Juju.
We'll skip the first sentence that says our website sucks.
Cool.
You guys know your website sucks. Okay. Then it was all good from there. It's like, other than that, everything else was great. All the communication on Facebook and Instagram was fantastic. You guys do a really good job on social media, hyping everything up with announcements and announcements about announcements, and all the other photos from Peyton and the other videos on Instagram. You guys are definitely taking a step up. Wish our local leagues were just like this. Keep up the great work. So props to you, Peyton. Props to you, Saw. Like,
props to you, Juju.
Yeah, too. I mean, I have so much fun doing running the Instagram and the Facebook, but it says something like you can put a face to the name, like you know people, like you know who's doing it or like who's running it. So like I like want people to know that I'm on it and I'm on the Instagram, because then they come and find me when they know they're going to do something. Like I had people flagging me down when they knew they missed the team photo and they're like, Juju, come back. And I was like, okay, I'll come and get you. Don't worry. You know, but just in general, like I was telling Saw, we had a ton of, I had a bunch of like Founders Cup players come up to me at the bar crawl on Friday. And they were like, your communication is so good on Facebook. Like we just like, we always know what's going on because you're posting about everything and you're telling us what's going on. Like we don't have to wait for an email, or you're like, you're already on it, or you're where we need to be. Like they're just like, you guys have elevated the communication, at least for this event, even for Vegas. Like it's being noticed. And so props to the whole team, because it's really on me.
No, and certainly I agree. I think the important thing is we try really hard on the communication. So I know we can't answer every email, like we try to, but sometimes they just fall through the cracks for whatever reason. But we try to make sure that everything's communicated on Instagram, on the Facebook group, they're posting announcements, and definitely in the emails I send out. So the emails, between the emails and the newsletters, 99% of any information you need is going to be in on there. And certainly if you hit social media, you open yourself up to a wider a group of the staff to be able to address questions. And so hopefully that'll help. And then certainly reach out to your captain. They're really good about reading emails. I know not everybody wants to read it, but I can promise you that everything that you needed to know about the event was in an email, in the Facebook group, or in the GMOT that we published. So you get your hands on one of those, save it to your phone. You can find all the answers. Of course, we're going to continue to try to be better. We're working on thinking of ways to have like a live Q&A session or chat box session throughout the weekend, and someone monitoring that on Facebook. So we're going to continue to improve. So we certainly appreciate your feedback. We want to make finding information as easy as possible, because I know sometimes you're drunk or you're tired and your phone's, you just want information easily and accessible to you. So we'll continue to work on that.
And I want to do a quick shout out just to CLUBWAKA for letting Saw hire more people that, you know, a media team. I think that it's actually making a huge impact, because we have the Juju, we have Robert, we have EJ, we have, it's a team. It's not just one or two people throwing things on there. It's people with actual, like, Juju's posts have like actual thought behind them. It's not just, you know, post a picture and like say a thing. It's information, it's fun things. And so I'm grateful that they let, I know Saw fought for it, and I'm grateful that they let him. So thank you, CLUBWAKA, for Saw.
Thanks, Jimmy. Thanks, CLUBWAKA. All right, on to, we're almost done here. I know we've gone long, but a lot of fun stuff to talk about. Question number four, what if any changes would you like to see next year? Juju, I'm gonna start with you. Which comment did you like the most out of that? What suggestion did you like the most?
Okay, my iPad just decided to stop working. Hold on.
All right, I'm gonna skip to Peyton. Peyton, what was your favorite one? We'll go you first.
Event shirt. I agree. I love event shirts. So one of them said, event shirt. I want a shirt that says Scottsdale. And please bring back the free booze. So awesome to have cases of Bud Light at the fields. That was a great surprise. But mostly just the shirt part. I know, you know, we all have too many CLUBWAKA shirts, but I still like love to wear them. And I it's always fun to like go to the next event in the last event's shirt and like kind of show off that you were there. And then people go, oh, did you go to that? Oh, that's awesome. There's something about just the event shirt that makes it way, like, I don't know, more real and more braggable to wear the shirt to other things. So I'm on board. Event shirt, Saw. Get on.
I've seen quite a few things.
All right, go ahead.
Yeah. Oh, this one is the best one. Here it is. It's Common 11. Just continue with gradual improvements. This one, this one thing you should never change is Saw.
Oh, jeez. Oh.
Again, who is he paying?
The other one is, no, it's, honestly, it said, it just like basically, Jimmy, this is my other one, okay?
I love this.
Shout out. It says, Jimmy needs to come out again. Seeing so much WAKA staff really makes a difference. This event also needs an event shirt. But seriously, Jimmy being here, like when I say people love to party with Jimmy, like people love to party with Jimmy. Like he is so much fun. We all love him. The players love him. And it's just like something that's so different with our community of being like the owner of our company, like knows us by name. Like no one knows, like people don't have that in other companies, you know? And Jimmy loves it. And like, I love that he stayed at the Hojo, was having the best time ever. Like first night out to dinner with everybody, like having margaritas, like the time of his life. And like, that's what he loves. And that's what our players love. And like, that's what this is about, because it, in general, at the end of the day, like it's a, just a huge, giant, dysfunctional family that we all love to hate each other and love each other. So it's like the best thing was Jimmy being here. So basically peer pressure, you're coming out next year.
Here, here. Definitely having Jimmy out there was great.
Yeah.
Huss, what do you got?
Number one, bigger hotel. I am a huge fan of party hotels. I know that Hojo has been a massive staple in this tournament since its inception. But I just being able to get everybody into one location creates a lot more of a social atmosphere. And especially with this hitting the numbers that it does every year, where it's continued growing and we continue seeing it starting to rival even WAKApalooza numbers earlier in this decade.
WAKApalooza Vegas. This is WAKApalooza.
Right, WAKApalooza Vegas earlier in this decade. Would definitely love to see a central location with a casino that we could all get together at and, you know, everybody could party at, and also maybe do something that also feels like Scottsdale, but also gives us that Vegas-esque feel, if you will.
No, I we had a lot of comments in here echo those same thoughts, wishing that the Hojo, the Hojo's great, but if there's a place big enough to host more people. And I don't know if you guys noticed, but Scottsdale is kind of bougie, and there are bigger hotels that it's a huge jump. You go from the Hojo straight to like 250 a night. So it's not like there's a middle ground.
Like realistically, like the hotels around in that area are not going to be that much bigger. That's the problem. So it's like, why not just stay with something that already loves us and they're working with us and they can handle our crazy?
That's true. And you also have to keep in mind the type of behavior we have at the Hojo. I mean, every year there's something that, let's say that. I don't know if Club WAKA can do the Marriott or the Hilton. I saw that as a comment on suggestion, and I think it's great that if you guys want a nicer hotel, quieter hotel, but that's what that is, and the Hojo is not going to be that. And if we put everybody together in the same hotel, we're going to get kicked out. The Hojo is the one place willing to deal with WAKA crazy.
They want us there,
or at least let it slide.
I think if we just continue with the Hojo and the people that want to stay at the Hojo stay at the Hojo, and there's tons of, like, I mean, how many teams stayed at Airbnbs this year? You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
Half of Scottsdale's Airbnbs, like, literally, like, we have more people in Airbnbs, and, you know.
We need to find,
because, I mean, we saw the Hojo in the first day every year.
So, you have
we need to find an Airbnb block.
I wish we
take over a neighborhood.
Take over a neighborhood.
The neighborhood I live in is literally like half of its Airbnbs.
There,
like,
you go. Club WAKA block party. Boom. 2021.
I'm not taking those photos.
Hojo's going to be something I think that needs to stay, because I think if we ever got rid of it, it would just be an uproar. And then it's, again, having a hotel that's going to deal with us is not going to be easy.
I think the other big thing that I noticed repetitively was also, to echo what you guys said earlier, the t-shirts for the actual event. I know the shirts were a massive hit last year. Props to Alex Sale for his awesome designs and always putting together such great graphics for just the events in general, but also helping us with that t-shirt design last year. And definitely would love to see more of that, and you know, kind of it echo into all the other WAKApaloozas that we do throughout the year, where we get it to that level where there's commemorative shirts and what have you that everybody can enjoy.
Mm-hmm. For sure. Good stuff. All right. Next question. We'll be able to go through the rest of this pretty quickly. Did you have friends, teammates who did not attend Scottsdale? If so, why didn't they? And it looks like most people, the responses here were really just schedule conflicts or just poor timing, or and then the other stuff is really just the cost of travel, which I think a lot of people had to deal with if they didn't plan on going on this event until like after the holidays. And we know it's tough. It's the first event after the holidays, but that's why we open up registration like we're essentially right after WAKApalooza Vegas.
Right. So
you book things. And ideally, most of the people that got flight sales booked their flights before Christmas.
Yeah, I noticed quite a few decided too late and airfare prices were too high at that point. Comments and everything.
There were a few other comments that it was Valentine's weekend. And I'm telling you, Scottsdale is a gorgeous city to celebrate Valentine's in.
You know, the one that stood out to me, and I'm going to pick on somebody, I don't know who it is, real quick, and I'm not actually picking on them, but somebody put not enough competition. There's 40 teams spread amongst three tournaments. So no matter what level you're looking for, whether it be FC, KO in the medium, or fun games, which I don't know why that'd be not enough competition for you, but whatever floats your boat. I don't know what to tell you. I mean, you had great teams that were availables, based teams such as Minaj and Fiesta de Basura. And you had great established teams like Word. You had other great established Sexabolics was a mishmash of Alcabolics and Sex Panthers, which have been staples in doing the competitive tournaments, especially in the Southwest for a multitude of years, as well as leagues. So it's one of those things where what I saw there was a lot of great competitors that I see at a lot of tournaments that I travel to throughout the year. And just seeing somebody say that there's not enough competition when you have 40 teams spread amongst three tournaments, that's just that's a cop out. That's a horrible cop out. Shame on you.
Well, I mean, I would play devil's advocate, and some people just like being in a tournament in their division that has like 40 or 50 teams. And the reality is, and we might as well address it, is, you know, a tournament that has more teams in your division sounds more exciting to win, right? And it almost sounds like the not enough competition comment came from someone that is in one of the top tier teams, right? And so, but the reality is CLUBWAKA, we're going, when you give more divisions, you're going to have less teams per division, even though we have a ton of teams overall, 40 plus teams. We go back to Founders Cup in Vegas, right? Back when Founders Cup first started in Vegas, we had up to 90 teams one year in Founders Cup Vegas. But that was the only way you could go to Vegas and play. There was no fun games. And then in 2012, when we implemented the fun games, that literally split the field in half, right? Half the teams went over to fun games and half the teams stayed in Founders Cup. And then in 2016, when we introduced the Kickball Open, then it divided everything up even more. And so last year for Scottsdale, we had 24 competitive teams, but we all kept them in one division. We didn't have an open. This right. year, we gave them that option, so it split it in half. So that's just the reality. And I think for players that want to see more competition, I think, you know, in the end of the day, there's only an X number of teams you can play, and it consolidates the competition so that people you face likely should not be a team that you blow out, because that's, you only get a limited number of games. And if you're blowing out somebody, you know, you're probably not getting your best bang for your buck, and they're probably not for both sides, whether you're getting blown out or the one blowing them out. So our goal here is to continue to grow tournaments overall. And by doing so, we want to have more divisions that align to people's expectations and skill sets. And so, yeah, the caveat with that is, you know, the ultra division, the elite, the varsity division, the Founders Cup division, we probably won't see 30 to 40 plus teams in just one division anymore. It just doesn't make sense.
Agreed. And it's one of those things where, and this is the thing where a lot of the people that are solely focused on the Founders Cup level, which, you know, again, I'm calling myself out too, because that's the level that I prefer to play at personally. But at the same token, it's one of those things where as we all start aging and we want to stay involved in a community that we've all been a piece of for such a long period of time, definitely look a little bit more with rose-colored glasses, if you will.
I'm listening.
To the kickball open, I saw, you know, veteran players that have been playing Founders Cup level for a long time, people like Patty, you know, playing and coming back and telling us how much fun he had playing in the kickball open rules, and just seeing the difference that it makes in as we all age. And, you know, some of us don't have that ability. I'm definitely hitting on my hitting my twilight. So definitely don't just shun the kickball open and the different rules.
Definitely. All right, I have a confession to make. I was the one who answered the survey and put that comment because I had absolutely no competition when it came to talking to the ladies out at the bars. So it had nothing to do with the game on the field. It was just like, man, I'm cleaning up tonight. This is ridiculous. You boys need to step up. So I need some competition because it's way too easy. All right, let's go on to the next question.
What did I miss?
Not much to discuss here. Question number 6, because I think this is interesting. Do you live in the local Phoenix Scottsdale area? And as you can see here, guys, 25% said yes, 75% said no. We have a ton of people at this tournament, but it's a lot of people traveling. So for those of you who live close, let's get your crew out. What can we do to get your crew to come on out? Come party with us. I know you already live in town, so the idea of like, oh, you know, Scottsdale doesn't sound so exciting to you because you're used to going to all these bars and clubs and all that other stuff. So definitely let us know. Reach out to us. Let us know what would make this a unique and fun experience for you. I would even bet that a lot of you guys, because it's a holiday weekend, you guys leave town. You're like, that's the last place I want to be.
I think the only thing that I can say to that is that Scott, we have like this weird, like our valley's really weird. So it's like Gilbert, which is like the east side of Scottsdale, Bougie, and we have the west side. And Scottsdale just has this like bad rep of being like super ultra bougie, and like people don't want to go there because it's snobby. But I mean, it's still really fun. If you, we go to the best, we go to good places that are not the,
I mean, you live there for a reason. Yes.
Damn.
I've been nice to
you. Shaw's not getting any more sunglasses for a while. You
know, up until that point, I really liked you. But
So question number 7, when did you arrive into town? You can see that a lot of people are, you know, what's interesting is a lot of people are showing up before Thursday. I was really impressed to see that. It looks like everybody is there by like Friday day, early in the day. So that's good. We'll continue to design parties and events to cater to that early crowd. I know there was a request for maybe doing something Friday day at lunch. So I know Juju's on that already. We're going to have something fun for you guys next year, something new.
This is going to turn into the week.
All day party on Friday, guys.
I know, right? And then question number 8, when did you leave town? Majority is Monday, Sunday evening and Monday. So that is impressive. I don't know if we want to plan any events on Monday. It's like a recovery day.
I loved how many people changed their flights during brunch.
Like, right?
There were so many people that were like, oh, I'm going to leave at my flight's at 11. My flight's at 1. And then you just see them like having a blast and changing their flights to like 6, 7, 8 p.m. just so that they can hang out like with everybody all day. That was like, for me, that was kind of a highlight and showing that we're doing a great job because everyone's having so much fun, they don't want to leave.
Right, pro tip, this event, stay till Monday. Don't stress out on Sunday. Have a good time with us at brunch and the Sunday after party. Don't worry about a flight, just Just if you need a place to stay, we'll consolidate. We'll help you find a place to stay. Stay till Monday. This Sunday is such. Somebody wrote on one of the other comments. It said, "Sunday onesie brunch is my favorite holiday," and I absolutely love that because it's true. Everybody loves it. This is a great event. Obviously, the last two questions are more for testimonial purposes. We'll announce in the GMOT who the winner of our customer experience survey are. We're going to pick three winners to win fanny packs and a free party wristband to WAKApalooza Vegas. Speaking of WAKApalooza Vegas, if you already didn't check out the first GMOT, we are back on the Strip this year. We are at Planet Hollywood. It's going to be great. If you don't know
how we all did that at the same time,
is about. We're going to play a quick commercial here right after this podcast that's gone on way too long, but we love it. This bottle of wine is literally almost gone. Look, you can see the line left. How much is left? I started with a full bottle. Look at that.
If anyone's still watching, you win $1 million.
I know, right? So let's do a quick wrap up. We got a couple of events coming up. The next one is Fort Lauderdale. Adam, I'm going to give you 30 seconds. Hype it up for us.
It's South Florida. It's cheap flights. You're partying at the Guitar Hotel at the Hard Rock. You're seeing some of the best nightclubs in South Florida on a VIP list. I cannot confirm or deny that you are drinking for free at some of these places, or at least there's a free keg on deck. So if there's something that you're looking for that is a good kickball trip and that is going to be cost effective, this is the one that you want to go. Not one single person has ever left here with saying that they've had a bad experience or spent more than they thought they were going to.
That's true. I've been down there with Adam. It's a great time. We have quite a few Dream Team members that are going to be joining you down there. So, and I already know a couple of folks that at Scottsdale that are coming on out. So that is great. Of course, we got summer camp coming up at the end of May. There's additional tournaments throughout the year. You'll see us posted in here, and we're going to post it in on our Instagram, on our channel, on all of our pages. So definitely follow up with that. If you are in the local Southern California area, 2 weeks from now, we're doing our first St. Practice Day, which is the Saturday before St. Patty's. It's St. Practice Day. We're going to do a bar crawl. Get your St. Patty's on 1 week in advance and have a good time. And, of course, email your boss now. Tell your family. October 10th weekend, 2020, WAKApalooza, Las Vegas, Founders Cup, Kickball Open, fun games, dodgeball, bowling, volleyball. We're all going to have it. It's going to be a great time. We're going to have tons of stuff. Make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. Hit the notification button down below. We'll see you guys again real soon. Thanks a lot. Thanks for sticking around with us. Juju.
Bye, guys.
Love you guys. Bye. Bye.